Rene von Eyssen, spa manager at the Aman Spa, the Connaught, Mayfair. Today we're at the beautiful Aman Spa inside the Connaught Hotel, just off Berkeley Square in London, with spa manager Rene von Eyssen, a very good friend of mine and someone who both Luke and I have known and worked with for quite a long time now. And I frequently get asked which spas to go to in London, and Aman is always my go-to, and I have no doubt that my journey in spa has taught me that a lot of that is to do with the spa manager. And so today we wanted to talk about Rene's journey in spa, how she retains her staff, and generally any helpful insight she has into the world. So Rene, hello.
Hello.
Hi. So we were talking to Anna, who is one of Rene's therapists.
Admin
now, but came back after a 5-year break.
Yes, she's travelled the world, come back after being to South America, Brazil, and back with us.
Which I think is the ultimate praise for a spa manager, for someone to want to come back and work for you. But before we get onto the hot topic in spa and staff retention, we met Rene probably 6 years ago now.
I was trying to work out how long ago it was. I think it was definitely, 2010, per chance.
And we got introduced or put together by the lovely Imelda at Content Wellbeing.
Content Beauty.
Content Beauty.
Yeah, if you've never been on her website, Imelda is literally the curator, really, of green brands. She is the kind of go-to in the UK and would be the press go-to. So she's been writing for The Telegraph. She has an uncanny knack of globally finding the upcoming green, natural, ethical brands, and she literally brings them to the UK. That is her skill set, isn't it?
Yes, and that's exactly how we got introduced to Pinks. Because at the time, and I think it's a little bit further back than 2010, we were working together on opening up the River Wellbeing in Battersea. And one thing that I've never been able to find was actual organic product range that works for manicures, pedicures, and especially waxing pre and post waxing treatment. And this was the first range that sort of appealed on everything rather than having all those synthetic ingredients. And I started using myself the pre and post waxing, which was a wow. It was really what it was meant to do, without creating too much oil on the skin so the wax doesn't stick, but then also the cooling and calming effect after that. And that's actually where the introduction came.
And so was it Imelda that had already seen the brand?
Yes.
And how far back?
And that was, I'm trying to think when that was, 2008, 2009.
Wow.
And how far back do you and Imelda go?
A little bit before that, we met up and we started with the project together. But my background really comes back way back when I started in 1994 as a therapist. And I started in a health resort in where everything was about health and wellness.
Was that in South Africa?
In South Africa, yeah.
For those and that was my accents.
Yeah, you can tell from the beautiful accent.
that was my introduction, and I'm very fortunate that my first job was on a health resort, and everything from that on flowed more into natural, organic, naturopathic
wellness. You've just never deviated from that line now, have you?
and you know, from that step, you know, coming into London working for Apothecary 2020 alongside naturopaths, working with Jalique back then.
You were working with Jalique as the product?
Yes, as the product with Apothecary 2020.
If anyone hasn't come across Jalique, Jalique were very early, like very, very early, like, yes, Dr. Hauschka type. up at that early. Time.
Yeah, well, actually the two of them worked together, and then Shalique went and did their own thing. So yes, it sort of goes back to that time, and always the search for real or organic, you know,
not never just ending search.
Not saying we are natural or on the bandwagon of organic ranges, but and that's been you know, in the spa industry, you can go Mediclinic, or you can go into more holistic complementary wellness, and the natural organics go into that flow.
One of the things I remember most when I first ever came to meet you, other than the very beautiful spa you had, was you mentioning Cowshed. And obviously, yes, as a brand, that at the point we would have met, Cowshed were just at their kind of peak where it was starting to become a big brand. What happened with them? What did you do in the early days? Were you...
So, I was the training and standards manager for Cowshed 2007, before I worked with Imelda. And, you know, Cowshed formed without wanting to be a big spa. It was really the owner at that time saying, I want to have beautiful amenities in the Soho House, in the rooms out in Babington House. And they engaged a local producer, and the owner then, Nick Jones, it's now changed a little bit, but he still has a big input, was very, you know, the spa was in a previous Cowshed. So they chose the name Cowshed.
Incidentally, we have just had lunch in the Cowshed, or that, so what was it, the Chiswick High Road.
Oh, okay.
We just come from there.
She's got a hotel and a Cowshed. So
that's it. And I've worked there as well. But any case, it grew because they used the beautiful botanicals in their shampoo, conditioner, hand wash, and hand lotion, and they used very quirky names. Yep. And people wanted to buy into the brand that way, and that's how it developed. So when I started there, it was early days, and it became more prominent in the spa. We worked on the Ugly Gorgeous range for pregnancy and maternity, and it's grown from there.
And so training wise you were in charge of the standards for the spa treatments, so yes, making sure
training and standards for the spas and the overall operations for the spas and new opening at that time. We opened Shoreditch House, we opened Forbes Place, yeah, yep, in Soho. So it was a lot of work going down in Cornwall, one of the connections with Soho House at St. Moritz.
Yep.
So a lot going in.
But I can always remember my overriding memory of that first meeting was the fact that you said the word Shalique, you said Cowshed, and I remember sitting there and going, amazing, I eventually have someone in front of me who genuinely knows possibly even more about organic and natural than I did, or equally. And I was like, eventually I found someone that understands and gets it. Mm-hmm. Because at that point, we were very early in Pink's Boutique, and we were being picked up by big, beautiful spas, but they were spas that were driven to it by a sustainability policy that had come down from a CEO saying, you must choose a green product. So I was never sitting with spa managers who had it at their core and had such incredible understanding. And I remember walking out and saying to Luke, I was like, one day Rene has to work in our world. She has to be in our brand or highly involved. That's like, because she knows an awful lot.
Going back to 94, and obviously, yeah, that feeling of well-being and being in that sort of environment and resort has obviously led, presumably, to where we are now in an Aman, which produced, well, their core line is wellness. There is a big difference in terms of the treatment delivery and the holistic nature and the feeling of being in here, compared to, you know, we've worked with Radisson and other people. Like, they just don't get it. They may buy the products, like Kirsty says, because of a trend or because of maybe an environmental policy, but it's not until you put the products with the right person in the right environment that you really get
what it's meant to be. And for us, you found us essentially and started our Aman journey, and it's without a doubt my favorite brand I work with and the shiniest brand we work with. However, what always amazes me is that nobody knows who Aman are. Like, you have to be presumably a certain set. I mean, any hotelier knows who Aman are, A-M-A-N, by the way, if you want to go Google them. Every hotelier you ever meet would say hands down that probably, well, they are the best hotel chain in the world. Yet the general people on the street, it's not a name that they have come about. How would you describe Aman if someone said to you, so who are these Aman people? what is it?
It's very, very interesting. Going back to the founder of Aman, Adrian Zacher, that wanted, found a beautiful place out in Aman, with Aman Puri is in Thailand, in Phuket, and he wanted to create a home for his guests. He was very, very well known, comes from a very wealthy background, worked in New York as a young person, went back and brought the Times to Asia, and very well connected with royalty, people in very high places, and would often entertain people in his home. And that's how Aman started, is, you know, having a place where he could build additional private villas and invite his guests, which could be royalty, statesmen, very, very wealthy people, invite them to come to visit him. And that's where Aman started. And when they first looked for people to come and work, and many of them, Aman's turning 30 next year, 30 years, are still within the company, within the original Aman Puri, have worked a lifetime for them. They did not say, come and join the new Aman resort or anything. It was, come and join the family. If you want to be part of the family, come and join us. And the aspect of, when we have our guests, we are inviting them as you would invite a dear friend to your own home. Aman spread. People wanted Adrian to, though he was invited into countries like Bhutan by the royal family, being one of the first hoteliers
to
go in,
get invited into Bhutan.
To say, please, can you create Aman? Yeah, so that we can invite our guests into the country. And one thing that he's held dear was to make sure that you always respect the culture, that you're not importing anything from any other country, that the culture is respected, and that experience runs through from the whole arrival process, in the language that you've greeted, that you actually feel the culture of that country, that the people you greeted are from that country, and the food you eat, the music, the sound, right through to the treatment, reflects the culture and authenticity of that country. So it's not a brand at all. They don't compare themselves to any brand at all, and that gives the freedom to do really unique things within the Aman.
And Aman means peace, is that right?
It's Sanskrit for peace.
And then each resort will be Aman something. So
yes.
Greece is Aman Zo, Thailand's Aman Puri. And how many resorts are we at currently? So Shanghai is about to open.
Yes, so closing on to 30 resorts internationally.
And London is very, very unusual. We are still the only Aman spa which is separate to a resort. So there
exactly.
is no Aman resort here yet. And so the Aman spa is actually within the Connaught Hotel, which has never happened before. But I always think it's amazing is it still has exactly feels as an Aman should.
Yes, that's true.
And there are Aman junkies, aren't they? What's an Aman junkie?
So these are guests that when they travel, they plan only to travel to the Aman resorts.
Good choice.
Such. They love the way they have discreet service, very, very discreet, intuitive service, it's not a standard operating procedure that you have in big hotels as such, but that they are treated very much on a human level as such. And that creates a difference in high-end luxury, because we are dealing with very high expectations. But when they come to Aman, they want to be able to completely relax and not have the uptight formal.
We were lucky enough to stay in Aman Venice recently, having done some training there. And I've been waiting to stay in one for 10 years, having been booked in the one in Borobudur in Indonesia and not being able to get there because the airport runway cracked after an earthquake. I've been devastated by the amount of times Kirsty's been able to stay in them due to training. We finally got to stay in one. And I can honestly say, when someone asked me whether it was worth the price tag, I didn't even think about that in respect to it's the ability to essentially be at home in somewhere so magnificent. I mean, it feels like your home. They, whatever they do with their intuitive service and the way they greet you and the way they leave you, it's odd. Their service is so good that they leave you alone until suddenly you need something, and then suddenly someone's there.
It's already there.
But before that, you'll just feel like you're in your own lounge or your own bar by the Grand Canal in Venice, and it just, it's fantastic. I mean, it's a really, but you have to genuinely experience it. You can't just look at it and get someone to tell you about it. Like, you know, you go and sit in the bar, you know, for an afternoon and do some work like I did, and at no point do you feel uncomfortable, like you shouldn't be there. And
it was really interesting because Luke spent the day on his own in the hotel while I was in the training room.
And very hard.
Over the last few years, obviously, I've been lucky to be in different Aman resorts doing training, but one of them that stands out was one of the times I went to Aman Zoo, and it was pre-opening. And so we were there for the 3 weeks before it opened, which was pretty crazy. But also one of the global trainers who was doing the Amanization training. So every single member of the team, from the guy who drove the taxi on arrival from the airport at Athens, every single member did 5 straight days of Aman training. And I shared a house with the lovely girl that was doing the Aman training. So she basically Amanized me. And talked me through every day what she'd done with them, and so I got a really good understanding of what, and I mean everyone, so every member of the food and beverage team, every chef, every cook, from whatever job to all jobs did the same thing. And I got to Luke at the end of the day, and one of the things he said to me is like, it's amazing, it feels like it's mine. And I said, you don't know, but that is exactly the point. And I gave him the run through of the whole concept being that you are meant to feel at home. There isn't a reception desk that you walk up to and someone says, Mr. Sheriff, nice to meet you. They already know your name. You can't find the toilet because there isn't any signpost, because you wouldn't put signposts in your house. Mm-hmm. And the towel isn't folded up like it would be in a normal hotel. It's hung up because that's how it would be in your friend's home.
A little thing.
Yeah, and it kind of seeped into your mind that you hadn't put it together yet. Yeah. And you're like, wow.
It was fantastic. But obviously it comes with a lot of work in the background, a lot of training, which segues nicely into our current debate in the Pink's office about training and recruitment and retention. Because we've spoken to a lot of our spas recently who are struggling a little bit with retaining staff, and obviously that has an impact, and then on retraining. And Rene seems to be somewhat of an expert at getting people to stay and come back. So we were asking her really, like, whether we think there's an issue in the UK, whether it's just a perception. I mean, there's always been high turnover in many spots, so maybe they're used to it. But Is it getting worse? Is it necessary? I mean, do people just accept it when actually, you know, you should be able to keep a therapist for 2 or 3 years?
Because currently, I think the industry standard is 12 to 18 months.
That's spot on.
And a 30% turnover in
stock. It is what's happening currently. But I think the first thing with recruitment is there is a lot of people out there that you can recruit, but it's recruiting people with the right motive and intention for the industry. What is their aim? What do they want to be doing? You know, if they've chosen becoming a beauty therapist or a massage therapist because it was the easiest course to do when you finish your A-levels, and that's not really the right motivation.
Right.
So for me, when I look at a CV, of course we look at, you know, what training they've done and what qualifications they have, but that means nothing if they don't have the right intention. So I would even take on a more junior person with the right intention and train them properly, that you know, then take on someone that's done every course in the book, but they have no heart.
And so the intention, do you find that out at interview? So you will ask them?
Yes, well, you get to know the personality, the drive, you know, why are they in the industry that they are in, very, very quickly. And is it just to be part of a 5-star hotel?
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
If that's it, you know, that's not really my my interest
in the person.
But is it that really caring attitude and that we are in service, you know, with a person like that I can work with? And so it's really at recruitment stage picking the right person. And then retaining is all about development. And giving the freedom for people to develop. In that comes the training aspect. So at the Connaught annually, and I have to budget for it and I have to work very hard for it, is that we do cranial sacral training. Now, do we say all our therapists are top cranial sacral therapists? No, they're not. But it does give them that extra sense within the treatment, no matter what treatment they do, to have a deeper connection and understanding of the guest in front of them. And little things like that people start like realizing it's not just being in a conveyor belt of doing treatments and focusing on retail targets, but it's actually, what is our intention? Our intention is, to make people feel well. Even if it's feeling better on an aesthetic level when you're doing a manicure, pedicure, or waxing, but the bigger intention, every little thing we do makes somebody feel well. And if they get a kick out of that and they enjoy the working environment that they are in, they grow, they develop, we nurture them, and we maintain them.
One thing I've always noticed when I've trained here is I will speak to therapists and you will be in the room and I'll say, oh, how's it going? Or what's happening? What are the plans? And they're like, oh, it's great. We're doing this. And then in 6 months' time, I'm planning on leaving and going and doing this course, or I'm going to Cambodia for a year and then I'm coming back. And you don't often hear that in front of essentially someone's boss. So I've always noticed that obviously those development plans and that open dialogue about actually as an individual what their plan is, that you support it, even if it means in 6 months' time you know you're losing a therapist.
Absolutely. So we've had one of our therapists, Peter, he's gone away for 6 months and he's done retreat, which, you know, it's not retreat like in wellness retreat, it's Buddhist retreat. So it's having that freedom that doesn't always fit into corporate HR protocols as such, where somebody's employed and they have to end their employment. Of course, that has to happen in order for them to leave 6 months. But they always know they've got a place to come back to.
And they do. For them, it's a home too. They have a home.
And that's, you know, that's the family concept with Aman. You join the family. We've got a saying, once you Aman, you are always within the Aman team. And they know they've always got a place to return back to. And I fully support, I'm very proud of the team that we've had and seen how they've grown out of the spa. We essentially have had 5 spa managers develop.
Yeah, and that's the amazing thing is that I'll go to different countries and I'll be like, Alex, what are you doing here? Or Pia, and that happens, doesn't it? And that is a bonus of being a global resort, in that they also know
they have development beyond their current job to aim.
There's not just one salon, one spa. There is an option. But yeah, I mean, London has fed the rest of Aman globally with spa managers, which, again, says an awful lot for you.
So very proud of them. But I think if you have that open mind concept of developing people, even though, you know, you've got to set them free, let them go out into the world, but they always say they've got
children.
A place to come back, or even being mentors for the next generation of therapists, to say these are the therapists that came out of our spa, is really great.
Yeah. I think you've answered the question I was going to ask, which was, a lot of debate is had about wages and what therapists should be paid, and obviously they should be paid fairly, but I think you've very clearly laid out the reason that that's not, that's not necessarily the reason why people stick around, and if that is their motivation, then maybe we're starting at the wrong point. And as Kirsten and I were saying, if you can find those people that get the treatments and wellness are about making the person feel better that you're working with, and you enjoy that, then of course everyone needs to earn a living, but the satisfaction is greater than the
paycheck.
I think a lot of the corporate very driven spas that we deal with are the ones that are then struggling to recruit, because they're looking to recruit essentially a worker. Yeah, essentially trying to fill a slot and not thinking more long term or more broadly about what they can do for that person and how that person.
And I can tell you what's sort of been the big driver with that is big systems like online bookings and discounted treatments.
Or 20 room spas that you can fill.
Exactly. So it becomes a big machine rather than a place of wellness and improving people. And making them feel well. So
we were talking about this in the car, and I was comparing some of them to McDonald's, and I think obviously you look at a McDonald's, and well, we could discuss McDonald's in depth, but Ray Kroc, the founder, found something that could be replicated, which is making a burger in a certain way. So you can go into any burger, any McDonald's in the world, and the burger tastes the same. And you think to yourself, well, they've obviously trained staff to do that, but they've just trained them to do a mechanical process. I think the thing that people undervalue about spa treatments and spa therapists is that you're training them to, deal with a person, and every person's different, and every environment's different, and every treatment's different. And that doesn't come overnight, and that can't be really regimented. Like I said, you have to have this open mind.
We were debating, because I would love to regiment. Yeah, I would like to be able to McDonald's therapist.
Kirsten would like to McDonald's therapist.
I would like all the manicures to go all the same all the time.
And Kirsten struggles with control. You may have noticed if you've ever listened to our podcast before. She likes being in charge of things. But I think the beauty of the Aman way and the way Rene deals with people is that everyone will find their own way. And you just have to be there to guide them and mentor them, and it's a very difficult skill to invite someone into a room and pick up on their vibes and what they need that day, and the idea that that could be done to the book every single time is probably,
I think, what we miss there is that we do want to standardize things and keep a proper protocol in ensuring the
customer gets
the level of service. But we need to think of it in a different way, so that that's just the standard, and that we deliver above that every time. So that forms your training, and your protocol forms your foundation.
Yeah.
And where do you take it from there on a personalized level of service?
And that's where you need the...
And you never deviate below that standard, but you always aim to exceed.
And that's where the recruiting of the right people comes in, because you need to recruit the person that looks at the protocol and thinks, well, that's what the bare minimum is, but I want to add more to it, as opposed to somebody that's just there for the paycheck, for sake of it.
And what we've done in the past is we've created a generation of therapists that are just protocol-based, with no deeper understanding of what we need to do. It's often... when I interview people, they know their contraindications, but they've got no idea why or how to apply it.
Or if you did say to them, yes, actually, I do have this, what comes next? What sentence comes next?
And
they
and
know a massage move, but they don't actually understand the benefits of the person they're doing.
And I've, you know, I even give feedback on trade tests when the trade test didn't go well, and I show people and I say, so what was that actually that you tried to achieve? Because it's all fancy movements, but there's nothing behind it, and it's not what I've asked for. And I think it's getting people to be intuitive, to focus their intention. Every step of the way is, what am I trying to achieve here? What am I trying to do for the person in front of me? And in creating that sense of awareness each step of the way in the treatment that you do. And you do that, it's more of a meditative state, being present and observant, rather than just doing it against the race of time to get the next treatment in.
And that is a huge thing. And it potentially comes possibly to price point in terms of journey length times,
mm-hmm.
or really just a management decision of how long people allow for treatments and the gaps between treatments, because I spend a lot of time being slightly angsty about the fact that my therapists I visit have lost parts of the protocols and don't do it. But if you're on a no turnaround time or a 5-minute turnaround time and you're running a busy Saturday back to back, to be honest, you kind of go into panic mode, and the bare minimum is someone gets cleaned house. And really you get to a point where that's all you can deal with. Have I got clean towels and have I got clean hands?
Mm-hmm.
And you kind of start running a life like that, which becomes a really sad process for everyone involved. And it will not be long before each one of them burns out, disappears. And any concept of brand, either for the product house or the actual spa or salon, just goes down the drain.
It's not dissimilar. We talk about lots of things on value for money. And I think one of the challenges is, whether it was the recession or voucher or some of these discount places, I think a lot of people think that they can get in a spa for 50 quid for the day and a treatment included, and they're not really maybe as discerning as they should be. But ultimately, I think you get what you pay for. Most things in life, I believe, you know, there are some people not delivering, but I think if you do a bit of research, these places that seem a bit more expensive are probably doing more in the treatment. They've got more turnaround time, and so my experience is, pay that little bit extra, find somewhere that they're doing it properly.
And it isn't because Rene is here, but hand on heart, the 3 best massages I've ever had in this country have been in this spa.
Yeah, the best massage I've ever had is in this spa, without doubt.
Wow.
Oh.
Thank you.
Without doubt.
And that really is absolutely telling the truth. I mean, I've been in a different spa every day of this week, and so people ask me all the time for spa advice, and I really say, sadly, there are very few spas I'd spend my own money in. And the Aman is one of them. It's been lovely to speak to you, and thank you ever so much
for your
insights, Rene.
Yeah,
for all your support over the years, because Rene has without a doubt been a little guardian angel for Pink's Boutique, and has been very supportive of Luke and I, so thank you very much for that.
Yeah.
Rene can make you feel better just by sitting in the same room.
She's like
the Jedi.
Oh, nice.
Spa Jedi.
It's my pleasure. It's really my pleasure. It's not about, you know, for me it's always been about integrity that people have, and the ethics. And even when I look at bringing in a agent therapist from, you know, on call from outside, I work very closely with the agent. I won't say their name, but I know it's someone that isn't giving me the cheapest offer for a person, but that pays their therapists well.
Yeah.
And you know, it goes, everything we provide to our guests, it's the therapist and it's the product, and of course a beautiful environment.
Yeah.
But if you undercut any one of those 3 to get a mass market in, then you know, you lose on integrity, and that's what it's always been for me. So whether it's making sure that therapists are well cared for and well paid and have a development program in place, that the product that we are using has that integrity, you know, which Pink's Boutique has been, and also being in a beautiful environment and not just a small little cubicle as such to practice from. You get those three right, and I believe you have a successful business.
It's a real shame that people can't see how beautiful the room is that we're sitting in. I'll take a picture. We'll post it alongside the podcast.
Amazing. Awesome. Good. Brilliant. Well,
I think I've summed it up better myself. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for a lovely afternoon, and thank you everyone for listening.
Great. Thank you.
See you next time.